हेलो फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज़ डॉक्टर पी आर चौधरी फ्रॉम के वाघ कॉलेज ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर नासिक। एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी अबाउट कंसेप्ट्स एंड स्टैंडर्ड्स ऑफ कैनिंग। द टॉपिक विल बी कवर्ड अंडर द कोर्स पोस्ट हार्वेस्ट मैनेजमेंट एंड वैल्यू एडिशन ऑफ फ्रूट्स एंड वेजिटेबल, कोर्स नंबर हॉट 366। द प्रोसेस ऑफ सीलिंग फूड स्टफ हर्मेटिकली इन कंटेनर्स and sterilizing them by heat for long storage is known as canning. So canning involves two main processes. First is you have to seal the foodstuff hermetically, that means in airtight containers, and later you have to sterilize those containers with heat so that the produce can now be stored for a longer period. There are various products such as fruit, vegetables, meat, sauces and confectionery products which can be preserved by canning. Canning does not involve use of any chemical preservatives. It is one of the important and safe method to preserve the food. Usually, canning is done when the raw material is available abundantly and is sold in the off season. This helps to get better returns for the growers. Also, most of the nutritional values of the fruits and vegetables are preserved in canning. Shelf life of the product can be increased, and this helps to increase availability of fruits and vegetables throughout the year and in distant marketplaces. Let us study in brief the history of canning. In the late 18th century, Emperor Napoleon Bonaparte had offered a prize of 12,000 francs to anyone who could prevent the military food supplies from spoiling. He wanted a better way of storing more diversified foods in order to feed his troops during military campaigns. In 1809, Nicolas Appert, a French confectioner, developed a new method of heat preservation of food in sealed containers. His work included packing food in glass bottles, closing them with corks, and heating the container in boiling water for several minutes. This is how the method of canning was developed. Therefore, Nicolas Appert is known as father of canning, and the process of canning is also known as appertization. In 1810, he also wrote the book The Art of Preserving Animal and Vegetable Substances for many years, which is the first known work on canning. In 1810, Peter Durant, a British citizen, got the patent for canning foods in tin or metal containers. And in 1817, William Underwood introduced the method of canning of fruits on commercial scale in United States of America. Most of the fruits and vegetables can be stored by the method of canning. Let's look into the most common fruits which are used for canning. It is mango, pineapple, apple, peach, apricot and orange. In addition, you can also see canned products like jackfruit, lychee, longan, pear, bananas, even banana blossom, etc. Commonly canned vegetables include carrots, peas, French bean, cauliflower, beet, tomato and tomato products. The different types of food which are canned can be grouped into four different categories on the basis of their acid content. First is the low acid content food, in which the pH of the food will be higher than 5. It includes most of the vegetables such as peas, lima bean, asparagus, cauliflower, potato, spinach, etc. The second group of canned food is the medium acid content food, where the acidity ranges between 4.5 to 5, and it includes vegetables like turnip, carrot, okra, cabbage, pumpkin, green bean, and various products like sauces and soups. The third group is the acid content group, In this, the pH ranges from 3.7 to 4.5, and it includes tomato, pear, banana, mango, jackfruit, pineapple, sweet cherry, peach, apple, and other fruits. The last group is the high acid content group, where the pH will be less than 3.7, and it includes mainly your citrus fruits, rhubarb, prunes, sauerkraut, pickles, and chutneys. Now, usually the bacterial spores can be easily destroyed when the pH of the food is less than 3 or at 3, which include most of your fruits. And if the pH is higher than 5 or it's between 5 to 6, that is most of the vegetables, it becomes difficult to kill the bacterial spores. In addition, bacterial spores do not grow or germinate when the pH is below 4.5. Therefore, when the canned products are having pH of less than 4.5, they can be easily processed by just keeping them in boiling water. But if the product is having pH higher than 4.5, then the processing has to be done at higher temperature of 115 to 121 degrees Celsius, that also under pressure. Also, we make sure that the center of the can should attain this high temperature in order to kill these bacterial spores. Now, there are various steps which are involved in canning of fruits and vegetables. It begins with selection of your fruits and vegetables. Then sorting and grading takes place, washing, peeling, cutting, blanching of the cut fruits, filling in the cans, syruping or brining depending on if it's a fruit or vegetable, exhausting, sealing the cans, heat processing them, cooling, and finally storage. Now let's study in detail different steps involved in the canning process. The first step is obviously selection of your raw material. Usually fruits and vegetables should be ripe but firm, evenly matured, free from any blemishes, insect damage or malformation. It is very important to harvest the fruits and vegetables at their proper maturity. Example, most of the fruits and vegetables are harvested at soft ripe stage, except for fruits like apple, pear, peach and banana. Harvesting is preferred at mature stage because at ripe stage these fruits will be very soft. Overripe fruits usually yield a very poor quality product, while immature and underripe fruits generally shrivel or toughen on canning. Most of the vegetables are harvested at mature stage so that they can withstand the cooking during sterilization. Except vegetables like peas, beans and lady's finger, they are harvested at tender stage and they should be free from any soil or dirt. Tomatoes used for canning are generally firm and harvested at fully ripe and uniform deep red stage. Tomatoes variety selected for canning are usually firm so that they can withstand the mechanical process of canning during processing. After harvesting, the produce is brought to the processing unit, and the first step which occurs there is sorting and grading. It is a very important step because it ensures the removal of any inferior or damaged commodity. You don't want to keep any diseased, damaged fruits in your processing because that can contaminate your entire product. Usually for sorting, inspection belts are used and trained people will detect the poor quality produce and remove them, which will be not suitable for canning. After sorting and grading, next step will be washing of the produce. Washing helps to remove all the dirt or any other microorganisms which are adhering to the fruits or vegetable surface. Most of the fruits and vegetables are washed, except in case like peach, apricot. They are usually live peeled and therefore they are not washed before peeling. Live peeling means you use hot caustic soda to remove the peel of fruits and vegetables, and after removal of the peel, then they are washed with water. Washing after peeling usually removes vitamins and minerals, as we all know, and therefore this is not usually encouraged. Various methods of washing can be used, example, soaking or agitating fruits and vegetables in water, washing with cold or hot water sprays. You can use mechanical washers. You can also use high pressure washers and chlorine water. After washing, the next step includes peeling, coring and pitting. These are primary unit operations for preparing fruit and vegetables for canning. Peaches, apricot, pears, tomatoes, etc. are usually peeled before canning. However, the fruits which are canned whole, including their peel, retain more nutrients. Depending on the type of commodity, peeling methods can be by hand or knife, by machine, by heat treatment, or by using lye solution. Heat treatment is by using boiling water or steam, example in case of tomatoes, where after blanching it becomes easier to remove the peel. And lye solution, as we studied in previous slide, is hot caustic soda. Cores and pits in fruits like apple, peach, apricot are removed by hand or by decorer machine. After peeling, next step comes is cutting, halving or slicing. The fruits usually are halved or cut into small pieces, either manually or mechanically. However, if the fruits are already peeled, they have to be submerged in water containing 1 to 2% of salt solution or acid in order to avoid enzymatic browning. The next step is blanching. Treatment of fruits and vegetables with boiling water or steam for short periods, followed by immediate cooling prior to canning, is called as blanching. Blanching is carried out either by hot water or using live steam. Usually, you have to use only soft water for blanching, as hard water toughens the tissue and destroys the natural texture. Another step which we follow is for prevention of browning. Some fruits which cannot be blanched due to their delicate tissue structure are treated with chemicals to prevent oxidative browning. Oxidative browning occurs due to exposure to oxygen during peeling and slicing. It is caused by the action of oxidase enzyme with catechol and tannins and is common in peach, apple, potato, mushroom, cherry, apricot, grapes and persimmon. Pineapple, tomato and melons are however not prone to browning reaction. There are various treatments which can be used to reduce browning reaction. First is sulfite treatment. In this, fruits are dipped in a solution containing 2000 to 4000 ppm of sulfur dioxide for 2 to 5 minutes. Sulfur dioxide fumigation can also be used and is commonly used for grapes dehydration. Second method is using acids. Low pH solution is known to act as an inhibitor for enzyme polyphenol oxidase and thus it inhibits the browning of fruits. Peeled fruits, slices or cut surfaces are dipped in solution of 1 to 2% citric acid. Also, other acids like citric acid, fumaric acid, tartaric acid, acetic acid and phosphoric acid can be used for prevention of browning. Third method is using antioxidants. Most commonly, ascorbic acid is used as an antioxidant in canning of fruits. It acts as an inhibitor of peroxidase enzyme. Ascorbic acid can be used or mixed with dry sugar, citric acid, or in syrups. Fourth method is using sugars. Sugar syrup is used to prevent browning in peeled and sliced fruits by inhibiting oxidation by partially excluding air in the tissues. Sugar is mixed with ascorbic acid and citric acid as an effective agent against loss of texture, color, and flavor. And the last method is by using salt. Dipping peeled and sliced fruits or vegetables in 1-2% salt solution also prevents enzymatic browning, as salt acts as an inhibitor for the enzyme polyphenol oxidase. The next step is filling of cans. Usually tin cans are used and they are washed, sterilized in dipping hot water tank, or they are passed through a steam sterilizing tunnel before use. Usually plain cans are used, but if the fruits are colored, like in plums, black grapes or strawberries, then lacquered cans are used. The fruit and vegetable, either slices, halves or whole, are then filled into the cans. After filling the cans, now you have to add syrup or brine depending on what your produce is. Cans are filled with hot sugar syrup of concentration 35-55% in case of fruits, while hot brine concentration of 1-10% in case of vegetables. Both syruping and brining helps to transfer the heat within the food pieces during the processing. It will also improve the taste of canned products, fill up the interspace between fruits or vegetables in the can. You have to make sure you add the syrup or brine at the temperature of 79-82 degrees Celsius, and by leaving 0.32-0.47 centimeter head space, by either manually or automatic machines can be used. Let's study in brief about syrup and brine and how they are prepared. Syrup is a solution of sugar in water. Normally sucrose syrup is used for canning. 1 kilogram of sugar in 1 liter usually makes 50% concentrated syrup. Syrup can be made up of 3 types depending on its strength: light syrup, medium and heavy. For preparing light syrup, you will require 1 kg of sugar in 2 liter of water. Medium strength syrup can be made by dissolving 1 kg of sugar in 1.5 liter of water, and heavy syrup can be made by dissolving 1 kg of sugar in 1 liter of water. On the other hand, brine is a solution of salt in water. Usually only vegetables are brined. Commercial salt of good quality, which is free from iron, should be used for brining. Hot brine of 1-3% strength is used. You can prepare brine of different strengths depending on the chart below. 1% brine can be prepared by dissolving 10 gram of salt in 1 liter of water. 2% brine can be prepared by dissolving 20.40 gram of salt in 1 liter of water, and you can keep on progressing depending on the percent brine strength you require. The next step is exhausting. Exhausting is a unit operation in which practically all air from the contents in the can is removed before sealing. The purpose of exhausting and creation of vacuum is to create an anaerobic environment in the can that would inhibit microbial spoilage. The removal of air from the content also reduces the risk of corrosion and pinholing of the tin plate and discoloration of the can contents. Exhausting helps in better retention of vitamin C. Expansion and shriveling of contents during heating help to avoid overfilling or underfilling of the can. Example, corn and peas expand on boiling in brine, while strawberries shrivel upon heating in sugar syrup. The vacuum in the can also prevents bulging of the can during storage at higher altitudes or in hot climate. It also prevents excessive pressure and strain during sterilization. There are mainly 3 methods of exhausting: thermal exhausting, steam exhausting, and mechanical vacuum sealing. In heat or thermal exhausting, the can covered with lid or which is loosely sealed or clinched is passed through a tank of hot water at 82 to 87 degrees Celsius, or it is passed on a moving belt through a covered steam box. In the water exhaust box, cans are placed in such a manner that the level of water is 1.3 to 2.5 cm below their tops. The time of exhausting varies from 5 to 25 minutes depending upon the nature of the product. At the end of exhausting, the temperature at the center of can should be about 79 degrees Celsius. During exhausting, the steam will replace the air inside the can and it is sealed while still hot. In steam flow or steam vacuum closing, high steam pressure is injected into the can headspace at 100 degrees Celsius for 5 to 8 minutes just prior to closing. Thus, all the air inside the can is quickly replaced with steam, which will condense and form vacuum following seaming. Steam vacuum closure coupled with hot fill assures very high vacuum in the can. And the last method is mechanical vacuum sealing. In high-speed mechanical vacuum sealing, the cans filled with the product and covering of syrup or brine are passed through a clincher that clinches the cans. It is also called as the first operation roll seam. But this will not form an airtight seal. The cans are subjected to a vacuum for a short period of time to remove the free headspace air, but not all dissolved gases within the product will be removed. Immediately after exhausting, the cans are sealed by using a double seamer. Double seaming is a two-step operation. In first step, the can lid is inserted on the can body hook by holding and rotating the lid in position can between two rollers. This operation is also called as clinching, during which first operation, roller gently guides the lid in the body hook. The next step is to press the seam using the second operation roller, which results in an appropriate overlap of the body hook and the cover hook, resulting in an appropriate countersink. Between the cover hook and body hook lies a layer of sealing compound, which ensures the sealing process. The critical parameters for an ideal hermetic seam are body hook, cover hook, seam thickness, seam width, and overlap, which need to be carefully controlled to prevent leakage in the can. The next step is coating and embossing. Coating of lid of the can is essential to identify the can once it is closed. The code provides the necessary information about the product, like name of canning unit, product packed in the can, date of packing, lot number, etc. Coating is done on the second lint, that is the end cover of the can, just before sealing. After coating, the cans are then heat processed. Heat process consists of heating cans to a predetermined time and temperature to eliminate all possibilities of microbial spoilage. Overcooking should be avoided as it spoils the texture, flavor, and appearance of the product. Usually, fruits and acid vegetables can be processed satisfactorily in open-type cookers with boiling water at 100 degrees Celsius, as the acid retards the growth of bacteria and their spores. While non-acidic vegetables, except for tomato and rhubarb, have to be processed at higher temperatures of about 115 to 121 degrees Celsius under pressure. It is required to maintain the temperature at the center of the can for a sufficiently long period to destroy the spores and more resistant bacteria. In the next step, sealed cans are rapidly cooled to approximately 35 to 40 degrees Celsius to stop the cooking process and to prevent stack burning. Cooling is done by immersing or passing hot cans in cold water tanks, by spraying cans with jet of cold water, by passing cold water into the pressure cooker, or exposing cans to air. Water used for cooling should be of non-corrosive, low in bacterial and yeast count, and chlorinated with 2 ppm of available chlorine. After cooling, the cans are stacked to allow the outer surface to dry, as even a small trace of moisture can likely induce rusting. The cans are labeled manually or using a labeling machine and packed in wooden or corrugated cartons. They should be stored in cool and dry place with temperature below 30 degrees Celsius. Adequately processed cans usually ensure an acceptable product quality up to at least 1 year. Storage of cans at higher temperature should be avoided to prevent the risk of thermophilic growth and spoilage. So we have completed studying the different steps in canning of fruits and vegetables. Now let us study about the containers which can be used for canning of produce. Usually, tin cans or glass containers are used in canning industry. We'll first study the tin containers. Tin cans are made up of thin steel plate of low carbon content, which is lightly coated on both sides with tin metal. It is difficult to coat the steel plate uniformly, and during the process of manufacture, small microscopic spots are always left uncoated, although the coating may appear perfect to the eyes. The contents of the can may react with these uncoated spots, resulting in discoloration of the product or corrosion of the tin plate. When the corrosion is severe, black stains of iron sulfide are produced. It is therefore necessary to coat the inside of the can with some material to prevent discoloration, and which will not affect the flavor or wholesomeness of the content. This process is known as lacquering. There are usually two types of lacquers used. First is acid resistant lacquer. It is golden colored enamel, and cans coated with it are called as R enamel or AR cans. These cans are used for packing acid fruits, which are of two kinds. First, those whose coloring matter is insoluble in water, example like peach, pineapple, apricot, grapefruit, etc. In such fruits, they are packed in plain cans. Whereas the second group is of those vegetables or fruits whose color is water soluble, example raspberry, strawberry, red plum, and colored grapes. Such fruits are stored in lacquered cans. The next type of lacquer is sulfur resistant lacquer. This lacquer is also golden in color, and the cans coated with it are called as C enamel or SR cans. They are meant for non-acid foods only and should not be used for any highly acid product, as acid will eat into the lacquer. They are used for peas, corn, lima bean, red kidney bean, etc. Tin containers are preferred over glass containers because of the following advantages: ease of fabrication, strength to withstand processing, light in weight, ease in handling, they are very cheap to process, and they can be handled by high speed machines. However, they also have certain disadvantages. Contents are not visible in cans, they cannot be reused, and they can contaminate the contents. Glass containers of different size and shapes can be used for canning purpose. They also have few advantages, such as contents are visible and clearly displayed in glass containers. They can be reused over and over again. Glass usually does not contaminate the contents. They are usually preferred for packaging baby food. Also, glass bottles are very good for home preservation. And if you are using glass containers, bottling does not need a sealing machine. The disadvantages of glass containers are high initial cost, they are heavy in weight, and being fragile in nature, extra care has to be taken during handling and processing. So So with this, we have completed our canning lecture. Thank you.